Assalamualaikum and hi. To answer the case study from Assignment 1 of Integrated Information System, I, Muhammad Shamin Halim, with ID of 53235313452 from class 7X BAV, selected to present the story of Helios Airways Flight 522. This accident relates to the cabin system failure. Helios Airways Flight 522 was a scheduled Helios Airways passenger flight that crashed into a mountain on 14 August 2005 at 12:04 p.m. Eastern European Time, north of Marathon and Varnavas, Greece, while flying from Larnaca, Cyprus to Athens, Greece. A lack of oxygen incapacitated the crew, leading to the aircraft's eventual crash after running out of fuel. Rescue teams located the wreckage near the community of Grammatiko, 40 km from Athens. All 115 passengers and 6 crew on board the aircraft were killed. With those fatalities, this was the deadliest aviation accident in Greek history. Flight 522 loss marked the 69th crash of Boeing 737 since it was brought into service. History of Flight 522. The aircraft involved in this incident was first flown on 29 December 1997 and had been operated by DBA in 1998 until it was leased by Helios Airways on 16 April 2004. And it was given the nickname of Olympia with registration of 5 Beta Delta Beta Yankee. The aircraft had arrived in Larnaca from London Heathrow at 1:25 that morning. The flight was scheduled to leave Larnaca, Cyprus at 9 a.m. local time and fly to Prague via Athens. The scheduled arrival times in Athens was 10:45 a.m. Hans Hergen Mertens, a 58-year-old German contract pilot hired by Helios for the holiday flight, was actually the captain. He had been flying for 35 years, including for Interflug, before 1990. And had accrued 16,900 flight hours. Pampos Karamlebos, 51, a Cypriot who flew for Helios, served as the first officer. Karamlebos had accrued 7,549 flight hours throughout his career. Luisa Vuteri, a 32-year-old Greek national living in Cyprus, replaced a sick colleague as the chief purser. Stages of accident. When the aircraft arrived from London Heathrow earlier that morning, the previous flight crew had reported a frozen door seal and abnormal noises coming from the right aft service door. They requested a full inspection of the door. The inspection was carried out by a ground engineer who then performed a pressurization leak check. In order to carry out this check without requiring the aircraft engine, the pressurization system was set to manual. However, the engineer failed to reset it to auto on completion of the test. After the aircraft was returned into service, the flight crew overlooked the pressurization system state on the 3 separate occasions. During the pre-flight procedure, the after-start check and the after-takeoff check. During these checks, no one in the flight crew noticed the incorrect setting. The aircraft took off at 9:07 with the pressurization system still set to manual and the aft outflow valve partially open. As the aircraft climbed, the pressure inside the cabin gradually decreased. As it passed through an altitude of 12,040 feet, the cabin altitude warning horn sounded. The warning should have prompted the crew to stop climbing, but it was misidentified by the crew as a take-off configuration warning, which signaled that the aircraft is not ready for takeoff and can only sound on the ground. In the next few minutes, several warning lights on the overhead panel in the cockpit illuminated. One or both of the equipment cooling warning lights came on to indicate low airflow through the cooling fans. This is a result of the decreased air density, accompanied by the master caution light. The passenger oxygen light illuminated when at an altitude of approximately 18,000 feet. The oxygen mask in the passenger cabin automatically deployed. Shortly after the cabin altitude warning sounded, the captain radioed the Helios Operation Center and reported the takeoff configuration warning on, and the cooling equipment normal and alternate offline. He then spoke to the ground engineer and repeatedly stated that the cooling ventilation fan lights were off. The engineer, which is the one who had conducted the pressurization leak check, asked, "Can you confirm that the pressurization panel is set to auto?" The captain, possibly experiencing the onset of the initial effects of hypoxia, disregarded the question and instead asked in reply, "Where are my equipment cooling circuit breakers?" This was the last communication with the aircraft. The aircraft continued to climb until it leveled off at flight level 340, approximately 34,000 feet. Between 9:30 and 9:40, Nicosia ATC repeatedly attempted to contact the aircraft without success. At 9:37, the aircraft passed from Cyprus Flight Information Region into Athens FIR without making contact with Athens ATC. 19 attempts to contact the aircraft between 10:12 and 10:50 also met with no response. And at 10:40, the aircraft entered the holding pattern for Athens Airport at the KEA VHF omnidirectional range. Still at flight level 340, it remained in the holding pattern under control of the autopilot for the next 70 minutes. The aircraft continued to climb until it leveled off at flight level 340, approximately 34,000 feet. Between 9:30 and 9:40, Nicosia ATC repeatedly attempted to contact the aircraft without success. At 9:37, the aircraft passed from Cyprus Flight Information Region into Athens FIR without making contact with Athens ATC. 19 attempts to contact the aircraft between 10:12 and 10:50 also met with no response. And at 10:40, the aircraft entered the holding pattern for Athens Airport at the KEA VHF omnidirectional range. Still at flight level 340, it remained in the holding pattern under control of the autopilot for the next 70 minutes. Two F-16 fighter aircraft from the Hellenic Air Force 111th Combat Wing were scrambled from near Anchialos Air Base to establish visual contact. They intercepted the passenger jet at 11:24 and observed that the first officer was slumped motionless at the controls and the captain's seat was empty. They also reported that oxygen masks were dangling in the passenger cabin. At 11:49, flight attendant Andres Prodromou entered the cockpit and sat down in the captain's seat. Having remained conscious by using a portable oxygen supply, Prodromou held a UK commercial pilot license but was not qualified to fly the Boeing 737. Crash investigators concluded that Prodromou's experience was insufficient for him to gain control of the aircraft under the circumstances. Prodromou waved at the F-16 very briefly, but almost as soon as he entered the cockpit, the left engine flamed out due to the fuel exhaustion. The plane left the holding pattern and started to descend. 10 minutes after the loss of power from the left engine, the right engine also flamed out. And just before 12:04, the aircraft crashed into a hill near Gramatiko. There were no survivors. The Hellenic Air Accident Investigation and Aviation Safety Board listed the direct causal chains of events that led to the accident as non-recognition by the pilots that the pressurization system was set to manual, non-identification by the crew of the true nature of the problem, incapacitation of the crew due to hypoxia, eventual fuel starvation, and impact with the ground. A 2003 flight of Boeing 737 between Marseille and London Gatwick proved that the cabin may have a pressurization fault. However, this is not apparent on the flight deck. A problem was first noticed when the crew began to feel some discomfort in their ears. This was shortly followed by the cabin altitude warning horn, which indicated that cabin altitude had exceeded 10,000 feet, and this was seen to continue to climb on the cockpit gauge. At the same time, the primary auto mode of the pressure control failed, shortly followed by the secondary standby mode. The failure of the pressurization control system was traced to burn electrical wiring in the area aft of the aft cargo hold. The wiring loom had been damaged by abrasion with either a P-clip or zip strip that over time resulted in the conductor becoming exposed, leading to the short circuit and subsequent burning of the wire. To conclude this presentation, a video simulation of Helios Airways Flight 522 were made. With this, I end my presentation with thank you. Assalamualaikum.
Helios Airways Flight 522 crashes in Greece. Helios Airways Flight 522 crashed on August 14, 2005 after a lack of oxygen incapacitated the aircraft's crew members and the plane eventually ran out of fuel. The plane arrived in Cyprus with a possible pressure problem. The pressurization system was set to manual after a pressure check. Just before takeoff, flight crews managed to overlook the error at three different opportunities. The aircraft departed Larnaca International Airport at 9:07 a.m., heading to Prague with a stopover in Athens. Cabin altitude warning horns sounded as the plane continued to ascend. Pilots misunderstood the warning signal due to hypoxia. Ground controllers lost contact with the plane at 9:20 a.m. At the same time, oxygen masks were deployed inside the cabin. Two Hellenic Air Force F-16 jets were deployed to establish contact when the aircraft failed to answer calls from Athens ATC. The jets observed at the time the pilot was missing while the first officer was unconscious. At 11:49 a.m., flight attendant Andreas Prodromo broke through the cockpit door and tried to land the plane, but was too late when the engines flamed out due to fuel exhaustion. At 12:04 p.m., the aircraft crash-landed into hills near Grammatiko, a village in East Attica, Greece. There were no survivors. It was the deadliest aviation disaster in Greek history with 121 fatalities and is the fourth deadliest involving a Boeing 737-300.